All right, so this is a wonderful booth called Play Monster. They make some great stuff. Jeff Foxworthy is doing an autograph signing, and there he is. Look at Jeff Foxworthy doing a signing. He's signing Relative Insanity. That is his game, and we're going to find out a little bit about the game and talk to Jeff. I've only been watching this guy for like 1,000 years. Well, maybe not that much, Jeff. Sorry. This guy's lucky from Play Monster getting a nice autograph. Hey, Jeff, how you doing? I'm Michael. Thanks so much.
Michael, good to see you.
Good to see you.
Yeah. And you have been watching 1,000 years. I've gotten away with this a long time.
A long time. How did your career start?
On a dare. I worked at IBM. I was the guy that was doing impersonations of the boss in the break room and always getting caught. And a bunch of guys I worked with used to go to the local comedy club, and they kept coming back, and they were going, "You're funnier than these people. You need to do this." And they entered me in a contest, not like an amateur night. It was for working comics. And I went and wrote 5 minutes about my family, and I won the contest. And I just knew a minute into it, I said, "I love this." I quit my job. My mother thought I had lost my mind. Her question was, "Are you on dope? You know, we can get you help." And 5 years later, I was on Johnny Carson, and the same mother is going, "You know, you wasted all those years at IBM," and I'm like, you know.
She's like, "I always knew you could do it. I'm so proud of you."
Well, yeah, exactly.
But were you working in Kingston at IBM in Kingston, New York?
No, I was in Atlanta at the time that I was doing it. Went to a club called The Punchline, and you know, I think I didn't never think I would be successful. I thought I'll do it a few years and I'll come back with my hat in my hand and beg for my job back. I just wanted to try it, and 34 years later, I still kind of keep my head down and my mouth shut going, "Oh, I really don't want to go to work again. This is too cool." I still love doing it.
I could imagine. And I would think that your instinct took over immediately because you made all the guys laugh at work making fun of your bosses, which we all do, right? Make fun of our bosses. And you didn't go to that humor. You went to humor that you thought the audience might gravitate to because they don't know your bosses. You'd have to do so much setup.
Well, that's exactly right. And people will say, "Well, so-and-so's funny at work." And I'm like, "Yeah, but when you're doing a show, they're all strangers. You don't have to share that same, you know, common knowledge." And so I was lucky with comedy, and I found what worked for me early. And it was, hey, if I think it, or my wife says it, or my family does it, I'm going to trust other people are thinking, saying, and doing the same things. And I've just always approached it that way.
Do you remember some of the jokes from your first 5 minutes?
Oh my God. There was something about, of course, this dates how far back it was. When people used to have the ashtrays, and I would say that dads would cut their toenails and they wouldn't throw them in the trash can. They'd leave them in the ashtray in the den so everybody could observe and admire them. And the big toe, it was like a boomerang. You tried to throw it away and it kept coming back. You know, something stupid.
That's pretty good, though. Yeah. I like that.
Well, the first time. But so, you know, when I approached this game, it was kind of the same way I approached writing stand-up. Is we were all together at Thanksgiving. My kids were playing Cards Against Humanity, and I said, "You got to go downstairs because your grandmother's here, your aunt and uncles are here." It was too dirty.
But it's a fun game. So we're
a great game. Yeah. A great game, but you couldn't play it in front of your aunts and uncles. So I'm thinking, all right, what can I do that we could all do together? And my idea with a game is if you laugh, you'll play it over and over again. So I literally went away and I wrote punchlines. I wrote like 1,000 punchlines. No joke, just punchlines. So I knew they were funny. And then I went back and wrote setup cards based on relatives, my cousin, my aunt, my grandmother, my brother, you know. And so somebody reads the setup, things like, "When my cousin walked in with her new baby, my grandmother blurted out blank." And then you look at all of your punchlines and try to submit the one that's going to get the biggest laugh.
And so, okay, so it's called Relative Insanity. What happens when you get a laugh? Are you judged somehow by the laugh and then you get points?
Well, the person that has read the setup picks which answer they like the best, and so you get a point for that. You know, it's a little bit like Cards Against Humanity or Apples to Apples. You know, when somebody picks your answer, you get the point.
That's awesome. We played that yesterday. It was a lot of fun. How do you approach Play Monster? I mean, they're a pretty awesome company, and I think we all like the game, right? And so now you came out with this game, but how do you approach them? How do you get to them?
Well, again, because of having decades doing this, whether it's submitting scripts or submitting television show ideas or whatever, at this point, it was like I wanted to find somebody that had a passion for it, because I've turned in scripts that when I got them back, it looked nothing like what I had originally written. And so, and I had worked on this. I mean, it was just note cards. And so as I'm shopping it to people, they were the ones that came back immediately and said, "We get this. We get this. We're sitting here playing it. This works. And so what they gave me back was what I sent them originally, you know. So.
That's pretty awesome. I'm checking the chat room. We're live on Twitch as well right now, and I want to ask some questions here from the viewers, and that's why I'm checking the chat room.
Right.
Some of them think I'm being rude by looking at my phone during the interview, but I'm actually paying attention.
You're working. You got
to multitask now.
Multitasking, yes.
How did the whole you know you're a redneck thing start?
Well, because people were calling me that, because I always wore jeans and boots, and when I was starting out in comedy, I'd had a truck and I drove it everywhere, and it was always good nature, whether it was in New York or Chicago. It was like, Foxworthy, you're just a redneck from Georgia. One night I was playing just outside Detroit, and they were kidding me about being a redneck. Well, the club we were playing in was attached to a bowling alley that had valet parking. And I said, wait, if you don't think you have rednecks in Michigan, look out the window. People are valet parking at the bowling alley. And I went back. I never thought it was going to be a hook or books. I just was looking for stand-up material. And so I knew what I was, but I wrote 10 ways to tell. And I tried it the next night. And not only were people laughing, they were pointing at each other. And so it was that, you know, finding that truthfulness in that included everybody.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. I like that. And I like that you use real life and you kind of observe.
Yeah.
Do you like observational comedy? Is that kind of how you modeled yourself?
Yeah, and well, see, I believe everybody has the thoughts that comedians have, but they go in one ear and out the other. They don't hold on to them. And comedians think it and they grab it and they're like, and so to me, the biggest compliment at the end of a show is when people goes, oh my God, you've been in our house, or I've thought that, or I've done that, and they never thought about it being funny, and you've made them laugh at themselves.
I like it. Who inspired you when you were growing up or when you were younger?
Yeah, well, you know, I was always fascinated by comedy. So when I was a kid, I'd save my allowance, I'd buy Bill Cosby records, I'd buy Flip Wilson records, I'd buy Bob Newhart records, and I'd memorize them and go to school and do them. And then as I got older, it was George Carlin and Richard Pryor. I had to get headphones for that, you know.
But George and Richard were the best, though.
Oh, my gosh, they were fantastic. The best note I ever got backstage, first time I played the Fox Theater in Atlanta, somebody brought a note to the dressing room, and it was from my high school principal, and he said, I cannot believe I am shelling out money to listen to the same kind of crap I used to try to put a stop to. Because I was in his office so many times with him going, what do you think you are, a comedian? Well, apparently so, Mr. Givens. It's on the sign, you know.
That's pretty awesome. That might be the pinnacle. I mean, that's like, you know, you've arrived.
Yeah, when your high school principal pays money to hear you do comedy, nothing beats that.
Especially when you've been at his office so many times.
Yeah, right.
One of the viewers wants to know what your favorite city to perform in.
Oh, my gosh. You know, one of the greatest things about doing stand-up is I had never been anywhere before I started. I've been to all 50 states, been to every part of all 50 states. So I've literally seen the country, met people everywhere. I couldn't pick a favorite because I think, you know, the accents change and the scenery change, but people are people. We all want the same things. The same things drive us all crazy. So I couldn't come close to picking a favorite.
Do you ever skew your act towards the audience or towards the city or the kind of the region?
Yeah, I mean, a little bit. But the core of it, I mean, you know, we'll address the little differences, but the core of it, I believe we're 85% all the same. And so, yeah, I mean, I'll acknowledge the fact that there's snow up to here and, you know, in Atlanta, there would be a million people dead if we had that. But for the most part, the things that I want to talk about is it's everybody. It's our common thread.
Are you smarter than a fifth grader? How'd that happen?
Mark Burnett called me and he said, would you host a game show? And I said, nah, that's kind of cheesy. I don't think so. I said, what's the premise? He said, adults taking an elementary school test for a shot at $1 million. And I started laughing. I said, that's brilliant because everybody's going to think they can do it. And as you quickly found out, nobody could do it. But it was fun because I could still be a comic. I mean, I could still kind of bust on people when they didn't know a first grade answer. And I love doing it.
I bet you used some of the skills you used in the clubs in the early days with the hecklers.
Yeah, well, because it's totally, you know, I had no prompter. You were totally thinking on your feet. Well, it was all those years in clubs that had given me that skill set. All I needed to know was your name and where you were from, and we could play the game.
It's pretty awesome. The game is Relative Insanity. It's out now or soon, I believe.
It comes out today.
Comes out today.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
That's awesome. One last thing before we let you go. Courtney is shooting for us. She's a huge fan. She wants a selfie to send to her dad. Can we do an on-camera selfie?
Yes, we
yeah,
can.
I want her to bring the camera up and everything. She's got to get the whole deal.
We're going to prove to dad. I'm going to hold this. And then you hold that. You ready? No, you made me look in that. You got to look in that.
Thank you.
Awesome. You are so welcome.
Thank you so much, Jeff. You're awesome.
Oh, you're
I really
welcome.
Appreciate it.
And what a fun toys. Are you kidding me? Somebody makes a living doing this?
Could it be better than this?
Yeah, it's pretty well. Comics pretty good. So, but this is right there.
Do you run around the show at all?
Yeah, because now I'm thinking, it doesn't matter how much money you make. We all like the free stuff, you know. So I'm thinking about going home with a suitcase full of toys so all my nieces and nephews think I'm the greatest uncle ever.
That's what you got to do.
Yeah.
Jeff Foxworthy, everybody. Thank you so much. We're going to keep rolling. It's Relative Insanity. Relative Insanity. It's out today. Check it out. From Play Monster and this man, Jeff Foxworthy. Thank you so much. Have a great rest of the show.
Thank you, man.
You too.